in School of Computer Science and Engineering, Kwinpook National University, South Korea between 2015 and 2016. He visited countries like USA, Japan, Serbia, and France. He wrote three research-oriented textbooks, one in the title Data Classification Using Soft Computing, the second one the title of Soft Computing for Microarray Data Analysis, and the third one in the title of Big Data and Hadoop, a classroom approach. Now, finally, he is a consultant in IEEE Foundation, USA-sponsored project, Smart Agriculture for Sustainable Food Production in the year 2017. Grant amount, $18,263. Track share in ACM, ACAC, ACAC-like Symposium on Applied Computing for 2016 in Italy, 2017 in Morocco, and 2018 France. He is a guest editor for Taylor & Francis Journal, Cyber Physical Systems, InterScience Journal, Delimitation and Clinical Practices, Hindavi Journal, Advances in Fuzzy System, and the MDB Channel, Journal of Sensor and Actuator Networks. Thank you, sir. Once again, I welcome all the participants to attend the 5 days FTP.
So thank you very much. Thank you very much. One and all. Before going into the topic, let me give you the agenda for these 5 days FDP. Participants as well as the organizer, I hope you hear my voice clearly. Okay, so the first day session, every day, the morning session is planned as a theory session, and in the afternoon session is planned as somewhat lab session, either in terms of some experiments or exercise or in terms of some kind of demo. So today, first session that deals with overview of machine learning, followed by I will introduce the concept of artificial neural network, and followed by I will give you an idea about basic ANN model, that is very primitive ANN models. In the afternoon session, it is introduction to MATLAB software. Tomorrow, the session will be like this. I will start with backpropagation neural network with its implementation challenges, followed by another special network called radial basis function network, and one more network called self-organizing feature map. So the afternoon session will be how to develop this ANN model using MATLAB software. The third day only, the core part of the seminar is FDP is there, that is overview of deep learning, convolutional neural network, and recurrent neural network. On that afternoon session, some kind of demo will be given how to develop CNN and RNN MATLAB software. The fourth day is the design of expert system with the help of the concept of fuzzy logic with respect to some case studies, followed by the afternoon session, how to develop a fuzzy logic control in MATLAB software will be discussed. The last day will be of something dealt with the problem of optimization, followed by the concept of optimization or the problem of optimization, how to be solved with the help of two different algorithms, genetic algorithm and particles optimization algorithm will be discussed with the code development in the afternoon session. So this is the agenda of this 5 days FTP. And I will tell you here one point, that my lecture is always very, 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 very basic and in the level of classroom approach. So I hope you understand, and I hope you will follow the rest of the sessions in a very fundamental and basic way. So let me go into the first part of today's presentation, that is overview of machine learning. What is machine learning? Before getting into it, let me have a small distinction between human and machine. So look at the picture. Here in this picture, I have given you the two scenarios. One scenario is a human is there, and another scenario is a computer is there. If a person is asking a question, who is your father, to a human, as well as to a machine, say for example computer, and what might be the response of both the things, that is one is living thing, another one is non-living thing. So in the first case, a baby, because since he is in the baby form, very young baby form, so he can recognize who is his father but can't say answer. Teacher who is asking a question to both the machine as well as to the human, who is your father? In this scenario, two things may happen between the two individuals. When you take the case of human, that is with respect to the baby, since the baby is very young form, he can recognize who is his father but can't be able to answer. Likewise, when the same question is asked to a machine, do you think that the machine can recognize and can answer? Definitely no. The machine can't recognize as well as can't answer. Why? What is the reality between these two scenarios? Because the first one is human and the second one is machine. So human has learned something to answer for this question. What question here? Who is your father? That is, human has learned something to answer for this question, whereas the machine has not learned for this question to give answer. So let me have one more idea here, the human learning. So human learning has happened over the stages of every man's life, from the baby form to very old form. In the baby form, parents are the teachers to teach the children what to do and what not to do. Likewise, when the baby grows from childhood to the young adolescent stage, then young adolescent stage to old stage, many people are involving to make the individual to learn about something. So these are the various stages of teachers available in a man's life. Above all, we have books. So a human is learning from parents, teachers, friends, society, life partner, colleagues, children, and above all, over the period of time, he has got some experience. So in every stages of walk of life, book is also there through which a human is learned. So from which he has acquired some knowledge, he has acquired some intelligence. Based on this, he is behaving in the society. Likewise, when you take the case of machine learning, so like why, how I take the previous slide in the form of baby to very old stage, the same thing I took the machine from very primitive machine model to the advanced smart model. So in all the cases, when you want to make a machine, what is required? So in case of human learning, in every stage, someone is there to make the human to learn about the people, learn about the concept, to learn about the nature, to learn about what to do and what not to do, like that. Likewise, when you take the machine, what is there to make the machine to learn? Of course, we are here to make the machine to learn, because we are the creator of the machine. As a creator of the machine, the human is the one, or human is the boss to the machine to make the machine to learn. In what way a human make the machine to learn? So by means of algorithm, a human makes the machine to learn. So how this algorithm has been developed, and how to develop algorithm so that the machine can learn anything that is intended to learn? So it is nothing but data. So with the help of the data, that is with the help of some inputs, the algorithm has been framed, so that the algorithm is converted into a program, and the program is fed into the computer or a machine, then the machine will produce the output that is expected by one. So the data plays a trivial role when you develop any algorithm. Before making the program, and where the data comes from, it is the problem text. So whatever the problem you are facing to solve with the help of machine, first thing you need is data. From the data, you need to devise an algorithm, and that algorithm is fit into a machine as a program, then the machine is said to learn, and the machine will work autonomously to give that expected solution. So here there occurs a two distinction between traditional programming and machine learning programming. In traditional programming, we have some inputs in the form of data, and based on the data, we have to write some program and we got the output. Whereas the concept of machine learning program is something different. Here we have to give data, and the data has to be divided into input data and output data. Both are given into the computer, and we need to devise certain procedures to make the computer to understand the data. That is to understand the input as well as the output. That means to study the relationship between the input and the output, those relationships are studied and comes out in the form of a program. And that program makes the machine to behave as an autonomous system or to behave as an artificial intelligent system. So this is the difference between traditional programming and machine learning programming. So in machine learning programming, you need to give data in the form of input as well as in the form of output, and what you ought to get from the computer is you ought to get a program, or you ought to get some kind of procedures through which your machine can understand the underlying pattern so that it can work autonomously, or it can work on its own intelligence developed artificially. So development of machine learning model. So if you want to develop any machine learning model, the first requirement is data. So as I said in the previous slide, where the data comes from? The data comes from problem context. So in general, if you want to develop any machine learning model, the data has to be divided into two sets. One is a training set, another one is test set. So the training set of data is utilized to develop the model by means of adjusting the parameter or by means of fine-tuning the structure. Once the training stage is set to occur, so then the testing stage is happened. In the testing stage, what it does is the trained machine learning model is used to verify the correctness of its behavior with the unknown data from which we can get the accuracy. The same scenario you take for a human learning model. Imagine a classroom in which students are humans as well as the teacher is also human. What is the data? Data here refers to any topic of the subject that you want to discuss with the student. So during the class hour, during the regular class hour, you are teaching the student in the particular topic. That is treated as training. During the training period, that means during the your teaching period, the student will take down notes. The student will try to understand the concepts. The student will try to solve the any idea or any problem that is taught during the teaching hour. Maybe over the period of training, maybe a 1 month period of training, the various topics of a particular subject, at one point of time, you will be having a class test for the student to say whether the student or whether the human can understand your subject or not. So it is said that during the class hours, the student is trained for the subject. And in the class test period, so your student used their knowledge that is gained during the teaching hour, and he has the position to answer for the question. So this is called testing period, and you are giving marks based on the answer provided by the student. So same scenario is happened in the machine learning model as well as in the human learning model. For human learning model, I am giving a classroom approach. And in the machine learning model, I am just saying that whenever you want to solve any problem or whenever you want to make a machine to learn about any concepts, the first thing you need is data. The data has to be divided into two parts. One is a training, another one is a test part. The training is conducted to develop the model, whereas the testing is conducted to verify the correctness of the model. So there are many different forms of learning available. See, say for example, our teacher, we teacher are making the student to learn in various forms. What are the forms we make the student to learn? We are giving assignments, we are giving some tutorials, we are teaching the problems in the board and asking the student to come to the board and solve. And of course, we are having many pedagogies, to make the student to understand the subject. Likewise, here also we have many learning models available, and all learning models are depend on the kind of the task that we are going to perform and the kind of the data that we are going to have. So the first and foremost one is our widely used one is supervised learning model. Here the data that is taken for the machine to learn contains both inputs as well as output. If the output has only discrete labels, then you are in a position to do only classification task by the machine. If the data contains output, the label contains real values, then the machine can do only prediction or regression task. Likewise, when you come to another learning model called unsupervised learning algorithm, here the data doesn't have output variable. It has variable, and all the variables are treated as input variable. It doesn't have output variable. In such a case or in such a form of data, what you need to do, go for is you have to go for unsupervised learning to make the machine to learn about the environment. And come to the third category of learning, semi-supervised learning. Here, the data has mixed form. Few data variables have inputs and few data variables have outputs. In that scenario, what you need to do is you can go for partially in the form of supervised learning and partially in the form of unsupervised learning. That is, it is a combination of both supervised and unsupervised learning, and it is nothing but semi-supervised learning. And the last one is reinforcement learning. Here, the training data doesn't have any numerical values. Instead, it doesn't have some kind of state as well as some kind of action. So these kind of learning is involved with the respect to the action of the learner and the corresponding action made by the algorithm developer. So based on that, the system will learn. So these kind of thing will be utilized in terms of some problems called decision making, that is autonomous gaming, machine related games, any of the things have been using this reinforcement learning model. So in general, if you want to go for the machine learning model, you need data, and based on the data, you need to decide what kind of task a machine can do. So here comes one question of the core part of our MDP, that is, what is deep learning? Here nowhere the idea of deep learning is introduced. What is deep learning? So deep learning is nothing but a learning conducted in depth wise. That is, the deep learning is a learning that is conducted across many different layers repeatedly. It may take any form. It may be a supervised learning, or it may be unsupervised learning, or it may be a semi-supervised learning. All four kinds of learning can come under deep learning. But the thing is, it is not shallow. That is, it is not one time happened. It has happened over the many layers. That deep learning is up. For more details, I will give you the days to come in my presentation. Okay, I want to make a machine to learn. Now my machine is set to learn. What a learned machine will do? A learned machine will do three different tasks in general. One is pattern recognition, that means identification of a pattern. Another one is decision making, that means we want to make a suitable decision so that we may encounter a good business process. And another one is optimization with several alternatives. So here also you can have some effective strategies while solving a problem. So these three are the major tasks solved by any machine. I hope you have an idea about what machine learning is about. So machine learning is nothing but developing some algorithms to make a machine to do these three tasks: pattern recognition, decision making, and optimization. So for the first 3 days of our MDP, we are going to dealt with neural network model. So these neural network model are very powerful to solve pattern recognition problem. Followed by the fourth day of our MDP, we are going to discuss about the fuzzy logic algorithm. This fuzzy logic is very much easier to solve the problem dealing with decision making. The last day of our lecture is going to deal with a kind of optimization problem which is solved effectively using genetic algorithm and particle swarm optimization. So with this, I close this presentation, and let me go into one more agenda of our topic of today's MPP, that is introduction to artificial neural network. So do you have any questions in here? Okay, if you have any question, you post the question. Later I will try to answer, because as we are running out of time, I am proceeding to the next part of the presentation. So introduction to artificial neural network. So before getting into the topic of artificial neural network, first you should know what for the artificial neural network is about. What for the artificial neural network is about? Artificial neural network is for to solve the problem of pattern recognition. So whenever you are talking about artificial neural network, it is to solve a popular problem called pattern recognition. So what is a pattern? So it is an object or a process or any event that can be given a name. So look at the small pictures in the slide. This is fingerprint, this is iris, this is someone's audio or speech, this is someone's face, palm, someone's handwritten characters. So you want a machine to recognize all these patterns. So this task is nothing but recognition. So what is pattern recognition in general? It is the act of taking in raw data and taking an action based on the category of the data. That is, by accepting this fingerprint, you have to say who is the owner of the fingerprint. By accepting this face, you have to say whose face it is. By understanding the handwritten characters, you have to say who is the owner of this handwritten character. So likewise, you need to do a task, and this task is called by the name pattern recognition. Let me have a small understanding before getting into the question, like who is good for pattern recognition. So in the very initial presentation, I have given you a picture which is asking question, who is your father, both your baby as well as your machine. Likewise, here the same thing is there, that is, who is good for pattern recognition, whether human or computer. All you know, humans perceive pattern effortlessly because we have a wonderful organ called eye. So the eye receives everything as a pattern in an effortless manner. And that pattern is fed into the brain, and the brain will have a suitable structure to understand that pattern. But what is the specialty of computer? Computer is in general a numerical machine that will solve any numerical problems within a fraction of a second. That is, computer always outperforms humans in terms of computational speed. When you ask a human to do this kind of task, he will take more time. That is, when you want to multiply two big numbers, human will take some more time when compared with computer. So what is the specialty of a human? The specialty of the human is the identification of the pattern in an effortless manner because of the wonderful organ present in them. What is the specialty of the computer? The specialty of the computer is its computational speed because of the wonderful architecture designed by the inventor of the computer. Now, what is need in the market? What is need in the market? The combination of humans' effortless behavior of recognition pattern and the computer's effortless behavior of speed. Both has to be combined and has to be present in the market for carrying out any pattern recognition task automatically. That is, demands for automatic pattern recognition system is required in the market, as well as for any societal problems you need to do or you need to create any autonomous system. Here I have one more question. Why human is good at pattern recognition? Of course, I have given the answer in the previous presentation. Why human is good at pattern recognition? Because human is good at pattern recognition by having a wonderful organ created by God, that is brain. Based upon the brain, or based on the functionality of the brain, with the ability to learn from the experience, human is very good at pattern recognition. The human brain is said to consist of enormous number of information processing cells. That is, it may count up to 10^11 number of neurons. And each neuron is treated as a processing cell by means of which the informations are processed to know what the information is about, to identify what the information is about. So across the brain, over the information are processed over the many number of neurons, and the neurons are treated as information processing device, and over the period of time, the human is able to do the pattern recognition task effortlessly. So to know how human is good at pattern recognition, you should understand how a biological neuron is constructed or is created or is functioned. Via axon and fed into the stomach. So this is the basic functioning of a biological neuron. So what is, once again repeat, the small fiber-like structure accepts the information, sensory information, and fed into the stoma via axon. And from the stoma, the information is passed to the neighboring neuron. When the neighboring neuron will receive the information from the stoma, that is, they see, look at the stoma. The stoma will have many dendrites around its structure. So all the dendrites start receiving the information, and these informations are getting accumulated into the stoma. The stoma is defined by a predefined capacity. If the information accumulated into the stoma goes beyond the predefined capacity, then the stoma will not accept any more information. Instead, what it will do is, it will pass the information to the neighboring neuron via axon. So the first duty of the stoma is accumulating all the information from dendrites. The second duty is sending all the information from stoma to axon once its capacity is reached. So now, what is our duty? We need to understand the biological neuron. Why we need to understand the biological neuron? Because if you understand the biological activity of your neuron, then it is easy for you to make a mathematical model about the work with the help of this biological activity, and then you can make an artificial one. So here, how can a computer be made a good pattern recognition system? So to make a computer to be a good pattern recognition system, the first thing is understand the biological neuron, study the functioning of a biological neuron, and try to think about the mathematical model suitable for the biological operation of the neuron. So how a computer can be made as a good pattern recognition system? The first thing is by simulating the functioning of a biological neuron. So as I said, there are two major functions of the biological neuron, that is the stoma. One is accumulation of information, function one. And what is the function two? Passing of information. When it is said to pass the information? Once its capacity is reached. Once its capacity is reached, it's said to pass the information from its stoma to neighboring stoma. So the accumulation of information can be treated mathematically, because the information is getting from various channels via dendrites. So it is treated mathematically with the operator called summation, and the process is called net input calculation. That is, input is coming. What is the total net input? Total input into the server. That is net input calculation. What is the function 2 of the biological neuron? That is 1/6 capacity reached. That is, once its limit is reached, once it reaches its threshold value, then it will pass the information by the neighboring neuron. So this function can be mathematically denoted with the help of some threshold value or by means of some activation function for producing the output. So while understanding the functioning of a biological neuron, you should understand the two major functions. One is accumulation of information, by means of which you need to have a mathematical model summation, and another one is passing of information, through which some kind of activation function is needed to do this kind of activity of a biological neuron. So when you are going to create an artificial model, you need to think about two things. One is knowledge acquisition, another one is storage of knowledge. Of course, this has happened in a classroom. In a classroom, if a student is listening to your class or to your teaching means, say for example, if a classroom contains 60 students, that means 60 human brains are listening to your teaching. 60 human brains are acquiring knowledge through your teaching. And 60 human brains are storing their knowledge in their brain. So there is an organ in the brain that I told in the previous slide, that is the synapse. It is the synapse which stores the trivial information of the subject or of the concept. So what is conducted in the biological neuron? Accumulation of information, passing of information. Accumulation of information, passing of information. It is conducted across a 10 to the power 11 number of neurons. And doing so, the trivial knowledge is stored in the synapse. So this is the way you can make an artificial system with the help of some kind of mathematical model. If you make this artificial system, then that artificial system is embedded into a chip, and the chip is integrated or deployed into a machine, so that the machine will behave as a good pattern recognition system in par with the human being. So this is the mathematical model, that is a schematic diagram of the mathematical model of the biological neuron. Remember the diagram that is shown to you that gives the glimpse of biological neuron. So what are the components of biological neuron? It has some dendrites, it has soma, and it has axon, and it has synapse. So dendrites are nothing but some kind of fiber-like structures that access inputs. So in the artificial neuron also, you should have some connections that access input. And that input is fed into soma, that is cell body. The duty of the cell body is partitioned into two. Remember, this is most important to discuss other advanced topics of the artificial neural network, including deep learning. That is, the soma of the neuron is divided into two parts. One part is doing the activity of summation, another part is doing the activity of threshold. So when that thing is carried out, the final output is taken by the axon, and this final output is fed into the neighboring neuron in the point where two neurons are connected. In the point where two neurons are connected, there occurs a small sponge-like structure called a synapse, and that synapse carries the trivial information. So here, one more advanced way of representing the functioning of artificial neuron. That is, the artificial neuron should have a set of input vector in the form x0, x1, etc. xn, and each vector is associated with a synapse to represent any previous information associated with that connection. And that input vector along with the synaptic weight vector fed into the soma, in which summation operation is carried out. Once the summation operation is carried out, over the summation, some kind of activation function is applied to get the output y. So this is the way activation function. This is the way a small artificial neuron is performing. So now, can you define what is artificial neural network? So artificial neural network is a network consisting of small processing element. How many number of processing elements are there? It is enormous. In brain, 10 to the power 11 number of neurons are there. That is roughly estimated. Likewise, a neural network that you are going to create artificially should have enormous number of processing elements. And all the processing elements, how it will process the information? It will process the information parallelly as well as in the form of distributed manner. So, what is an artificial neural network? It is a parallel and a distributed processing system consisting of huge number of simple and massively connected processes which are intended to input and output, so that for any unknown input, it is expected to produce the desired or expected output. So these are the many classifications of artificial neural network. So based on the classifications of based on the architecture as well as based on the learning algorithm, we can categorize the artificial neural network. With respect to architecture, we have different types: feed forward, feedback, recurrent. This is not competitive, this is convolutional neural network. Feed forward, feedback, recurrent, as well as convolutional neural network. And based on the learning algorithm, it is supervised learning, unsupervised learning, reinforcement. This is the three forms, and one more form I left out, that is combination of supervised and semi-supervised. And what is deep learning again here? It is nothing but if the supervised learning algorithm is applied in many layers, if unsupervised learning algorithm is applied in many layers, if reinforcement learning algorithm is applied in many layers depth-wise, then that algorithm is going to be simply in the form of deep learning. So we will see in the days to come. So these are the various developments of artificial neural network. So the research in artificial neural network has been conducted in the year 1949 up to till now. So many developments have been carried out. So my next presentation will be of explaining these primitive models. What is McCulloch's model? What is F model? What is perceptor? So each and every model, a little bit, I will give you a glimpse of idea how the model have been developed, and what is the motivation of the researcher, and what is the output of the model, or what is the limitation why we need to go for it. See, for example, 1943 McCulloch's model have been invented, but over the period, that is up to 6 years, that same model has been utilized by the researcher. In the year 1949 only, so another model have been evolved. Likewise, over the period, that is with the power of necessity, necessity is the mother of invention, so many models have been developed. For your understanding, see, in the year 1982, there is a model called the Hofield network model. So this model has been came into picture before the backpropagation model. And this model is right now very recently called as RNN, recurrent neural network model. So both the convolutional neural network model and the recurrent neural network model are not very new or latest model. It is of the model that is derived from the already existing old models. So it is better for you to understand the basic and primitive models before going into depth about the latest, more advanced kind of. Here is a small video to understand what is neural network.
This is a simulation of a single biological neuron. Information flows in, is processed by the neuron, and the results flow out. This gives the neuron its abilities to react based on previously learned patterns. Technology duplicates this by creating a structure that processes information like a biological neuron does, except this process is mathematical instead. Just like the biological neuron, information flows in, is processed by the artificial neuron, and the results flow out. This single process becomes a mathematical formula that can be used for simple problems. For those that are mathematically inclined, this will look similar to a polynomial. A polynomial is limited to the problems it can solve for, as shown in this graph of an order 5 polynomial. If this is all artificial intelligence could do, it wouldn't be much use. As with the brain, artificial neural networks' power is in connecting sets of neurons together in layers. When you connect them in layers, the mathematical formula becomes something like a multidimensional polynomial. This allows complex problems, like what is shown in this graph, to be discovered and used for our benefit. As before, information flows in and results flow out, but this time the input to the second layer is from the output of the first layer. The exact steps for a single layer are simply repeated for each layer of the neural network.
The last part of the today morning session, that is very primitive ANN models or basic ANN models. So in this presentation, what we are going to see is some primitive models, Mikulov-Pitts neuron model, HEB network, perceptron network, Adeline, Madeline, and the problem of linear separability. Participants, please note it down. For each model, we are going to study architecture, net input calculation, output calculation, weight updation. These four things is most and most important for understanding not only the basic model, but also the most advanced recent model, RNN and CNN. Four points: architecture, net input calculation, output calculation, and weight updation. So what I am going to teach you is, for each of the above model, that is for Mikulov-Pitts model, these four parameters. For HEB network, these four parameters. For perceptron model, these four parameters. Likewise, the final part of our presentation will be going on. So let me come to the first part, that is Mikulov and Pitts neuron model. So this model is shortly called by the name MP neuron, and it is mainly used for realization of logical gates. First point, what you should know about architecture. So look at the diagram. So Mikulov-Pitts, the scientist, they have given an architecture for a simple neuron as a two-layered architecture. One is input layer, another one is output layer. So strictly speaking, input layer is not counted as a layer, because its duty is to just pass the information. So output is the only layer that is counted. So when you look at the Mikulov-Pitts neuron model, how many number of layers are there? Only one layer. Even though physically I am showing you two layers, logically or computationally it is only one layer. So there are two diagrams given. One, the diagram one is below the presentation is having a bias connection. That is, you can have a neural network architecture without bias or with bias. So what is bias? Bias is something connected to the network by having some fixed or standard values. This is needed for some kind of learning purposes. I will explain you later this idea. So first, what you should understand when you start learning about the neural network model architecture. So what is the architecture of this MP neuron? It is a two-layered or one-layer architecture which consists of single output node. You know, please note it down. It consists of single output node. Even though physically two-layer, it consists of only one node that is present in the output layer, whose duty is to produce the output. Now, you treat this output node as a node or as a node with respect to cell body or soma. So in the previous presentation before the video, or in the video also, I have shown you the duty of the soma. What is the duty of the soma? The soma does two duties. What is the first duty? It does the operation of summation. What is meant by summation? It is the nothing but the product of total input multiplied by the weight coming to the node. And what is the second operation? It is the threshold operation. What this operation is about? This operation is nothing but once the information reaches the threshold, that is predefined value, by means of some optimization function, then it will produce the output, that is y. So with respect to Mikulov-Pitts neuron model, the architecture is this, and the next important parameter is net input calculation. What is net input calculation? Summation. What is summation? It is nothing but calculating the total input to the network. So the formula given is Y in, that is Y is the node. In this Y in is net input, that is Y in. What is Y in? Y suffix in represents net input coming to the node Y. It is calculated as summation I equal to 1 to N Xi Wi. That is X1 into W1 plus X2 into W2. That is the net input. If it is with the bias, then the bias is added as a separate term V plus summation I equal to 1 to N Xi Wi. So this is the way a net input is calculated for the Mikulovitz neuron model. After net input is calculated, what do you need to do? You need to do a threshold operation, or you need to do a activation function over the net input. So that is represented here, or this is otherwise called by the name output calculation. That is, over the net input Y in, you need to apply F, that is F of Y in, that is equal to either 1 or 0 depending on the threshold value theta. If the total input Y in reaches the threshold value theta, and if it is about to cross the threshold value theta, then it produces 1. In case if it produces the value less than the threshold value theta, then it is produces 0. So this is the way way you have to understand the Mikulovitz neuron model. Here I left out one thing. What is the thing I left out? See, look at the previous slide. For each model, what you should understand? Architecture, net input calculation, output calculation, and weight updation. In Mikulovitz model, what are the things we learned so far? Architecture with bias and without bias, net input calculation with bias and without bias, and output calculation with the help of activation function. What is left here? Weight updation is left here. Yes, weight updation, the task of learning or the operation of weight updating is not studied by these two scientists in the year 1943. So in the year 1943, when the Mikula and Fritz invented a neuron model by studying the human brain, he studied only the architecture of the brain, and he studied only the basic operation of the brain doing the two activity, summation and threshold. He didn't study the activity of learning. That's why he didn't introduce the concept of weight updation. He didn't introduce any formula for weight updation. So the very basic primitive Mikulovitz model consists of only three ideas. One is architecture, second one is net input, and the third one is output calculation. No weight updation is right here. So this may be a little bit useful to you to understand how the calculation is carried out with the help of each neuron. So say for example, this kind of architecture is given to you. What is the architecture? 0.3, 0.5, 0.6. These are all treated as x1, x2, x3. And 0.2, 0.1, minus 0.3. These are all treated as w1, w2, w3. Given these two values, in terms of a neural network model, you need to calculate the net input. So what is the formula for net input in case of empty neuron? X1 W1 plus X2 W2 plus X3 W3. If you substitute the value, you got minus 0.007. So likewise, you are in a position to calculate the output also. So this is the net input calculation in terms of bias. See, the bias, the one which is in the vertical direction. So the bias value is always 1. But the weight of the bias value is varying. So the weight of the bias value plus X1 W1, likewise, you need to calculate the net input for any neuron, for the MP neuron model. How to calculate the output? That is, once you calculate the Y in, what is Y in? Summation of I equal to 1 to N Xi Wi. Once you calculate the Y in, over the Y in, you need to apply a function F. So here it is stated that calculate the output using binary sigmoidal function. So this is the mathematical expression for binary sigmoidal function. What is this? 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus y in. So once y in is calculated, then that y in value is substituted in that formula to get the final output. So this is the way you need to calculate the output for the MP neuron. Now come to one more example. How to realize the logical gate using MP neuron? So for which, what you need? You need the data. So this data is nothing but truth table.
For what is the truth table of an AND gate? X1, X2, Y. X1, 1, 1, Y, X2, 1, then Y, Y. If any one input is 0, then the output will be 0 in case of AND gate that you know very well. So for which we need to consider or we need to assume initial weight W1 and W2 as 2. How W1 and W2? Because we have 2 input. For each input, what you need to have? W value. So for X1, what W value? For X2, another W value. Accordingly, it is named as W1 and then W2. How the architecture is? This is the architecture. So here, what is given? Only data is given, and you need to realize the MP neuron. So for input 1, 1, if you calculate the Yin, 2. For input 1, 0, the Yin is 1. Likewise, for 0, 1, it is 1. For 0, 0, it is 0. Now, I want to design a threshold value so that I have to produce the output accordingly. So when the input 1, for the input 1, 1, the output is 2. So if you make this 2 as a threshold value, then I can easily make the AND gate using this MP neuron. That is, whenever the net input calculated is equal to 2 or more than 2, then it will produce 1. Otherwise, it will produce 0. That is, it is a small, simple binary step function whose threshold value theta is defined as 2. I think you have understood how the theta value is set. The theta value is set arbitrarily based on the experience or based on the values that you got for the net input value. Accordingly, you have to decide based on the truth table. Then come to the another network model, HEV network model. So in the year 1943, Mikulopits, I understand the brain operation and have come out with the neuron model. It is called the MP neuron. And then followed by new Mikulopits in the year 1949 have devised a network model. He only observed the brain didn't do only the two operations, that is summation operation, threshold operation. It will do another operation called learning. That means the information is passed across the neurons. Over the information passing across the neuron, something has been happened. That means the synapses information is getting updated every time. So the synapse in the biological version is treated as weight in the natural version, in the artificial version. So he introduces the term weight is not a constant one. Weight is a varying one. So in the Mikulopits model, you could see weight is treated as a constant one, that is W1 and W2 is taken as 1. Also, in all the previous example, the weight values are given. But naturally speaking, the weight values are unknown. And it is our duty to understand or to find the weight values. To be speaking in general, that is, the learning in neural network is nothing but weight updation are nothing but finding the suitable values for the weights. So in general, I said that when a machine learning programming model is developed, what is to be given to the computer? Input and output is given. And what computer did? It will study the relationship between input and output by means of some parameter. And that parameter is nothing but weight. With the help of the weight value only, we need to predict the output. So the HEP only understand the weight parameter by means of learning, and he introduced the weight updation equation. What is the weight updation equation? This is very simple. That is, new weight is equal to old weight plus change in weight. Change in weight is represented in the form of del W. Whenever you want to go for a new value, it is nothing but addition of old value plus some change in value. So what is the change in value and how we define the change in value? How HEP define the change in value? The change in value is defined by the HEP as product of X and Y. What is X? It is nothing but set of inputs. What is Y? It is nothing but expected output. So this kind of HEP model is most suited for bipolar data, and it is popularly used for the task of pattern association, classification and clustering. So in HEP network, what is discussed? Weight updation is discussed. And what about architecture? And what about input calculation? And what about output calculation? So if you take this case, input calculation and output calculation and architecture, all are same with respect to Mikulopits model. So the Mikulopits model have defined an architecture. The same architecture is for HEP network. The input calculation in the Megalapix model is same for HEP model. The output calculation is same in the MP Meuron for HEP model. But the difference and the idea that is introduced in the HEP network is weight updation. So what is the weight updation? If the general formula for weight updation is old weight is equal to new weight plus change in weight. Likewise, bias. Old bias equal to new bias is equal to old bias plus change in bias. How to calculate the change in weight? It is the product of input and output. How to calculate the change in bias? It is the product of y. So in this way, the HEP network model have worked out. So let me talk about the same with the help of HEP network model for a AND gate. So since it is treated as a bipolar input with respect to bias connection, so I have it is noted that the values taken are 1 and 1, 1 and minus 1, minus 1 and 1, minus 1 and minus 1. Instead of 0, here it is taken as minus 1. So here, see, initially the weights are set to 0, not the weights are fixed as 1. Initially the weights are started at the random value of 0 or maybe some value between 0 and 1. But over the period of time, the weight values get adjusted by every time calculating the new weight using the formula old weight plus changing weight. So if you could follow this slide, so you can easily understand how the new weight value is calculated from the old weight value. At the first iteration, what is the old weight value? It is 0. When you substitute this old weight value 0 for the first iteration calculation, you observe that the new weights are 1, 1, and the new bias are 1. So this is the calculation of change in weight, that is LW. So in this way, HEP neural network model have used the weight updation equation as the formula for updating the weight value from a randomly guessed initial weight value. This is the tabular form which shows the various iteration by means of each and every iteration, how the change in weight value has been calculated for this simple HEP network model. Participant, you please go through this after when I share this PPT. Right now, you just understand that weight updations are carried out in the HEP model. Next model is perceptron model. As I said, when you want to study any neural network model, four things you need to study. One is architecture, that is given in the next slide. Another one is net input calculation. Third one is output calculation. And the final fourth one is weight updation. In perceptron model also, the architecture is same with respect to MP model as well as HEP model. Net input calculation also same. Output calculation is also same. Meaning is different kind of activation function will change different kind of output, but the output is same. That is, over the net input, you have to apply a function. With respect to different function, different kind of output will be what. So the final one is weight updation. Here the change occurs with respect to every model. In MP neuron model, no weight updation. In HEP model, there is a weight updation. In perceptron model also, there is a weight updation. Then what is the difference between HEP model and the perceptron model? Look at the formula. So the general formula is new weight is equal to old weight plus changing weight, that is delta W. How delta W is calculated? There occurs a difference between HEP model and perceptron model. In HEP model, delta W is calculated as the product of X and Y. Whereas in HEP perceptron model, Rosenblatt's perceptron model, the delta W is calculated as the product of alpha T X. What is T? It is nothing but target. And what is X? It is nothing but input. Now you need to understand what is alpha. Alpha is the learning rate. It is a parameter which is used to accelerate the learning of the ANN that I will discuss when I discuss the BPN model. What is a T? It is a target. So what is the difference between T and Y? T is the target, that is actual output. What is the Y? Y is the output produced by the network. That is, when you simulate the model, you will got one output. That output is nothing but Y. But actually you have some output, that is the target. In a classroom approach, Y is nothing but the answer performed by the student. And T is nothing but the answer key that you have for valuation. So that is the output Y and the target T. So what perceptron has suggested? Perceptron suggested that the delta W, that means change in weight, is calculated with the help of three parameters. One is alpha, another one is T, another one is X. It is a product of alpha, T and X. So change or the dissimilarity or the difference between the HEV model and the perceptual model is the way in which the del W is calculated. Del W is XY in terms of HEV model, and the del W is alpha into TX in terms of perceptual model. Come to the another model, that is underlying adaptive linear neuron. So here also the architecture is similar. That is, what is the architecture that is followed in MP neuron? What is the architecture that is followed in HEV? And what is the architecture that is followed in perceptron? The same architecture is here. That is two-layer architecture. What is two-layer architecture? Input layer that consists of set of input nodes, and the output layer that consists of single output node. So along the input node and output node, there are connections associated with parameter W1, W2, W3. So what is the change here? Here also, the change here is notified in terms of calculating the change in weight, that is del W. So the weight updation formula is old weight, new weight is equal to old weight plus change in weight. Old by new bias equal to old bias plus change in bias. Same thing here, but the change in weight value, that is del W, is calculated as alpha into T minus Y into X. What is T? Target. What is Y in? Net input. When coupled with the previous formula, it is alpha into T into X. When you compare, when you take this formula, it is alpha into T minus Y in X. And this value T minus Y in is nothing but error term. That is, what Adeline suggests is, when you calculate the output, the network will produce one output, and that output is F of Y in, and that F of Y in should be subtracted with the actual output, that is the target that you expected, and that is the treated as error. And this error term should be utilized to update the weight. And this approach is very popular approach. Even now it is followed, and this approach is called gradient descent approach. And this rule is popularly called by the name least mean square rule or Pitrone half rule. So what is the change here? Alpha into T minus Y in. What is Y in? It is net input formula. That is XI into WI, X1 into W1 plus X2 into W2 plus XN into WN, etc. So that is the value for Y in. Next come to another model, that is model line. So in model line, there is a huge difference in the architecture itself. Look at the architecture. In the previous three models, MP model, HEV model, perceptron model, Adeline model, in the previous four models, how many layers are there? Two layers. Input layer or output layer. But what is the layer introduced in the modeling model? One more layer is introduced, and this layer is called with the name hidden layer. But by count wise, it is taken as two layers, only two layers. You take the count, it is two layers. So physically, you need to this model is a two layer model. In input layer model, multiple adaptive linear neuron output. So here also there is only one output, that is single output Y. So here, how the calculation is conducted? See, Z1 is treated as soma. X1 is soma? No, X1 is not soma. It is just a passing. XI is soma, it is not a soma. XI is soma? No, XI is not. From XN. What is this arrow? This arrow is bias. So bias is not that much treated as for calculating the weight values. So it is separately calculated. So how many connections are there? 3 connections. So how to calculate the net input? Xn into W11, Xi into Wii, I1, and the Xn into Wn1. Likewise, come to Zj. Zj. The connection, one arrow, that is the arrow from X1, another arrow is from Xi, another arrow is from X. So, the net input X1 into W1j plus Xi into Wij plus Xn into Wnj. So, if you look at it over the connection, there is some weight values there. You should get a product of that weight value. Now, in Z1, you have to apply threshold. If you apply threshold, small Z1 comes out. If you apply threshold, small Zj comes out. If you apply threshold, that is acting as small Zm comes out. Now come to the Y output load. So you divide the output load Y into 3, Y into 2. What is summation? Another one is threshold. If you divide the 2, what is the summation? Small Z1 into V1 plus small Zj into Vj plus small Zm into Vm. So that is the net input calculation. Over the net input sum, activation is applied to produce the output Y. So here also, here the major change is architecture, but the net input calculation, net output calculation are varying with respect to layers. So each layer you have to calculate, that is net input calculation hidden underlying unit, output calculation of hidden underlying unit, net input calculation to the modeling output unit, output calculation to the modeling output unit. And what is the output formula? The output formula, that is weight updation formula, is new weight equal to old weight plus alpha into t minus zj xi. That is nothing but the weight updation formula used in Adeline. So the weight updation formula for Adeline as well as Madeline both are same. Only thing in Madeline, the architecture is different. What is the architecture? It is the architecture with the introduction of one more layer, and the computation is carried out in that layer also. In all the previous model, no more computation is performed in the input layer. Only the computation is performed in the output layer. So when I give this neural, when I give this MP neuron, when I give this MP neuron, when I ask a question, what is the neuron? What is the neuron exactly here? Or what is the soma exactly here? It is nothing but this one. Why? Not X1 and X2, because X1 and X2 are just a passing unit. It is not a computation unit. So whenever a unit computes some information or process information, it is treated as artificial neuron. So final conclusion with this modeling model is you need to understand the concept of linear separability. So what is mean by linear separability? So whenever a set of data is given to you, your objective is to divide the data into its equivalent patterns. See, look at the diagram. So here, this is the two-dimensional view of a different set of patterns given, and these different set of patterns have been divided using an artificial neural network. If these patterns are linearly separable, then these models are very easily solvable. So whatever the neural network that we studied so far, how many neural networks we have studied so far? Mikulapitz neuron model, HEP model, perceptron model, Adeline model, Madeline model. All the 5 models are very easier and powerful to solve any data given to it, provided that data should possess one characteristic. What is the characteristic? Is the data should be linearly separable. If the data is of nature that is linearly separable, then it is easy for you to use those 5 ANN models to proceed the pattern recognition task. But look at the point here. Most of the real world problems are non-linear in nature. So nowadays the problems are not only non-linear but also unstructured, highly complex, and many things are getting into the data. So in order to address those non-linearity, these structures are not possible. Then we need to go for more than one kind of model. That model is nothing but back propagation neural network model that we discussed in the tomorrow class. So I will do the revision of the content that we discussed in this particular presentation. So in Mekulla Pitts model, HEP model, perceptron model, Adaline model, in all the four models, in all the five models, in all the four up to Adaline, architecture is same. Whereas in Madeline, one more architecture is introduced, that is hidden layer and output layer. In Mekulla Pitts model, only net input calculation and output calculation is given. Whereas the HEP model to perceptron model, Adaline model, Madeline model, all what is given? Weight updation formula is given. And how to calculate the weight updation? The weight updation del W is X, Y. In terms of HEP, alpha into TX. In terms of perceptron, alpha into T minus Y in terms of Adaline. And two different stages of calculating the weight updation in terms of Adaline. So this is the simple comparative study between the various primitive models. Let me come to the linear separability problem once again. So when you take the case of logical gates, OR gate, AND gate, XOR gate, this is the truth table of OR gate, this is the truth table of AND gate. I can say that the problem of OR gate, the problem of AND gate are linearly separable problem, whereas the problem of XOR gate is non-linearly separable problem. Because if you plot a graph for linearly, if you plot a graph for OR gate, if you plot a graph for AND gate, you could divide the graph value into two things. One is containing 0, another one is containing 1. Look at the OR gate, output variable is Y. What are the two classes present? One is with the 0, another one is with the 1. There are two classes present. But the output variable is 1, the number of classes is 2. What is the variable? Y. How many classes it is having? Two classes. One is with the 0, another one is with this 1. Likewise AND gate, likewise XOR gate. Output variable is 1, output values are 2. So now I want to debate output values by a simple straight line so that 1s and 0s are easily separated. In case of OR gate, AND gate, it is easily separated by a simple straight line like this. But when you draw the same graph with respect to XOR gate, it is not easily separated. Do you know how to draw this graph? X1 is one axis, X2 is another axis. Look at it, the first line. X1 is 0, X2 is 0. That means this point, the orange color dot. X1 is 0 and X2 is 0. Look at the second one. X1 is 0, X2 is 1. That is, X1 is 0, whereas X2 is 1. That is, this purple color square. Look at the third one. X1 is 1, that is, X1 is 1, and X2 is 0. That is, this purple square. If both are 1, then this purple square. Likewise, you draw a graph for these three logical gates, and you observe that the OR gate and AND gate are linearly separated, whereas the XOR gate is not linearly separated. That is, we can't devise a single straight line for this nonlinear problem. Many of the today's problems are nonlinear in nature, and to solve these kind of problems, MP neuron won't help. HEP, perceptron, Adaline, Madeline, all these five neural networks model won't be a helpful model for us. The only thing we need to go for some advanced model to solve these kind of problems. So that model is nothing but a feed-forward neural network model trained by a backpropagation algorithm that we will see in tomorrow's class. So afternoon, there is a presentation with the MATLAB software. I hope with this I will finish the today's session. If you have any question, I am here to answer your questions. Organizer, can I have some time to answer the queries of the participant, or we will close the session?
Okay, sir. Proceed, sir.
So if anyone is asking a question, then I am ready to answer the question.
Please raise your hands, those who are having queries. Sir, shall we stop the end the meeting, sir?
Okay, sir.
Sir, one more.
Meeta K has raised the hand. Yes, ma'am, can you ask a question?
Sir, can you kindly unmute Punita?
Oh, I have to unmute.
You are the host, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, actually, deep learning. Can we write the program in Python, sir?
Yes. See, the artificial neural network is an algorithm only. It is a conceptual algorithm. You should understand the concept, and then accordingly you should write an algorithm. So once your algorithm is ready, you can write even in Java also.
Okay, sir.
Our focus of this FDP is to give some hands-on demo using MATLAB software, and it is very easier for you to write the code in Python also. For which you need to go for a specific package to understand the role of each and every inbuilt APIs. And if you follow the APIs and if you follow the instruction, then you can very well develop the model.
Okay, sir. In this FDP,
I will explain the basic concepts pertaining to each and every operations of the RNN and CNN. Once you understand the operation, then pertaining to that operation, you can look into the basic API available in the Python package. Then you configure that package and then you can use it to develop the model.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more question also, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, for perceptron method, our output, our target or output should be in zeros and one D. Otherwise?
Yes, ma'am. They are all binary units. Even RNN is RNN, CNN also the final layer, the output is taken as in terms of probabilistic value. It is containing zeros and ones. I will explain those during that session. With the help of a softmax layer, we will have the conditional probabilities for each and every category. So based on the probability, you have to apply a threshold value. If it is above the threshold, you can treat that as a particular output category. Otherwise, we treat that to another output category. So normally, the output unit of any neural network model is a binary unit, so in zeros or ones.
Okay.
So sir, it is the unit which is giving a probabilistic value, but the probabilistic value should be decoded into a value containing zeros or ones. I will teach you that one very clearly in the days to come.
Okay. Sir, one of the application which is having a table which is only one input and one output, sir. For that one input is voltage and output is also the voltage.
Okay. So
we have to give this as a training as well as testing and all. But for that application, which type of method or learning algorithm can we use for these?
For your case, I mean to go for regression model.
Regression model
is very easy for you, because it is one-to-one concept, so regression is very easy.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Most of the task that is dealt in this FDP are pertaining to classification, but regression is also very easy. Only thing, you need to develop a mathematical model of the form OU equal to MX plus C. That is, you need to use a form, then you can go with that.
Regression.
Regression task.
Okay. So these are all optimization techniques, isn't it, sir?
Not optimization techniques. The first 3 days of our FDP dealt with the pattern recognition. Fourth day of the FDP dealt with the decision making. Last day only optimization.
Okay.
So first 3 day, I mean to say that it is classification means classification, clustering, regression, and prediction. Four activities are somewhat similar to one another.
Okay.
When you take the case of clustering, it is little different when compared with the classification. That is following totally an unsupervised one. Whereas if you take the case of prediction as well as regression, both are same.
Okay. Thank you so
much. So in the first part of the machine learning slide, I have given some insight. Supervised learning, unsupervised learning. So it depends on the data.
Okay, sir.
So since you say that your data is having only two variables, input and output variable, and you want to predict
what I am telling is my what I am telling is input may be various attributes, but output should be not zeros and ones. It should be some other values.
That is value prediction. Prediction or regression. Even artificial neural network can also be used for the prediction task by means of some modification into it.
Okay.
Prediction and the classification both are same, ma'am. If you take the case of the data in the output category if you have continuous value. So in the machine learning PPT, I have introduced the supervised learning. There are two types of tasks of supervised learning that you can perform. One is classification prediction with respect to output variable. If the output variable is a discrete label, you can go for classification. If the output variable is real value, like you said, if it is a real value, then you go for prediction. Prediction can be either conducted with the help of regressive model, regression models, or it can be done with the help of neural network model. Some simple change in the final layer. Because neural network will always give the probabilistic value of the target that we are expecting.
Zero.
It is classified not between 0 to 1. Between 0 to 1, it will be giving. So based on the classification label that we have, we will be applying the threshold, make it as 0 or 1. If you don't want to have 0 or 1, you want only the probabilistic value, you can take directly as such. And that direct value can be utilized for prediction.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your time.